التمرة ريكورد.
Today, we have four super fantastic panelists to help discuss
prevention and adoption of SRI to further spread its benefits for both people and planet. So on our panel today, we have Dr. Erica Steiger, a tropical agronomist who's been working on agroecological methods in Africa for the past 30 years and on SRI globally for the past 15. A real leader, Professor Steiger has developed best SRI practices with farmers, provided training and technical assistance in over 17 countries, has co-led the design and implementation of two scaling projects for 13 countries in West Africa, and has co-organized the first SRI regional conference for Latin America and the Caribbean, introduced SRI to Haiti, and is also working on regenerative organic SRI systems in the United States. Super impressive. I'm so happy to have you with us today, Erica. And then Dr. Adnan is a researcher, academic, and development worker based in Kano, Nigeria. He works for the Climate Smart Agriculture team of LINCS, a project funded by the FCDO and delivered by Tetra Tech in northern Nigeria. He's actively engaged in the LINCS SRI project that pilots the adoption of SRI by smallholder farmers in Nigeria and measures both the economic and environmental gains from SRI. Then we have Mr. Unnikrishnan Nair, the head of the climate change at the Commonwealth Secretariat, who looks after the climate change program, leading its flagship program on the Commonwealth Climate Finance Access Hub and the Commonwealth Living Lands Charter. Welcome. And finally, last but not least, Professor Jacqueline McGlade is the co-founder and chief scientific officer at Downforce Technologies and a professor of public policy and natural prosperity at UCL UK and Strathmore University in Kenya. She was previously the UN Environment Program's chief scientist and former executive director of the European Environment Agency, and her expertise is in nature-based solutions for food security, climate adaptation mitigation, marine plastics, ocean health, the circular bioeconomy, and intergenerational prosperity. She's an advisor to the European and UK space agencies and has designed geospatial, fuzzy logic, and AI applications. Very much welcome to all of you. So for the format today, each panelist will share a short insight into their current work with SRI, and then we'll be having some questions and a discussion, and there'll be a chance for the audience to ask questions, and then a final closing remark from each panelist. So first of all, I'd like to turn to Erica, and if you could give us a brief sense of your current work with SRI.
Thank you, Kelly, and thanks, Nika and SRI 2030 for inviting me. It's great to have a panel at the COP on SRI. I mean, that's been long coming, and very, very happy to be here. Thank you. As you mentioned, SRI was developed in Madagascar, and for the past 20 to 25 years at Cornell University, we have network building. It's a knowledge hub, and there's a very large network worldwide, and with SRI being validated in more than 60 countries. So we have the experience. You know, we have the experience for different climate zones. We have the experience for different rice cropping systems. It's validated. So I think what needs to happen is the scaling up. So I've been involved with many different programs right now in West Africa with the RECOBUS project that will get started in January, scaling up SRI to 150,000 farmers in 13 countries among Nigeria. On the other side, we also launching a new project to kind of scale SRI through carbon credits, so we become self-funded and independent in this scaling. So that is something I think, you know, we need to start scaling, and I think we are ready. Technically, we are ready for it. Experience-wise, we are ready for it. Network-wise, we are ready for it. And so just need to keep going and doing the job.
Thanks very much, Erica. Self-sustaining, a self-financing model would certainly go a long way in helping us to move this forward. So Jackie, can you share an insight into your interest with SRI?
Thank you very much, and hello to everybody online. It's great to have you here, no matter what time you're watching. We have a huge gap in the way that emissions are currently being calculated in terms of you know, we talk a lot about energy infrastructure and many, many other ways that people are familiar with. And unfortunately, agriculture is always sort of painted into a corner as the big bad and negative. You know, emissions from rice, emissions from cattle, and so on. The list is endless. So what I did when I left the UN was I wanted to redress the balance. I really wanted to come at this from both an analytical point of view, an accounting point of view, nationally determined contributions, all of that side of it, to really say, but there's something on the other side. We need to be able to feed people, but actually people who have land have the greatest impact on sequestering carbon. And so when I sort of thought about it and the scale up and the speed that we need, I decided to take all the science and all the data that I'd spent 40 years building with colleagues all around the world and try to create the very best carbon and nature-based accounting systems that we could. And of course, you know, you have soils that have got virtually nothing in them and soils that have got a lot. And in between, you've got every kind of crop that people want to grow. And always rice and irrigated plants are stuck out as being tricky, very difficult. And so with the team, we've been able to develop ways of actually looking very accurately every 10 days at how much carbon is being sequestered. And then along comes SRI. How do we fit that into the picture? Because a lot of the time, it's underground. But we can also look at water. We can look at that whole kind of ecosystem of how you grow rice. And what we're able to detect in other crops as well, cotton as well as rice, just the diminution of the resources needed to grow the amount of rice that we need. And when you start to scale that up around the world, I'm completely convinced that this SRI approach, which in the end is an extension of traditional ways of growing rice, which is the other side of the story, will not only contribute to nutritious food, but will essentially start to help governments limit the emissions of things like methane to below 5 gigatons, because we have to do that. It's not just about carbon dioxide. So I see that SRI is a genuine and, as Eric has said, validated approach. And I think that downforce can not only demonstrate that, but can attract the kind of investment where people feel confident in the data that they'll actually invest in that transition and the training that we're talking about. So I see the two sides, the science and the data at scale, but also then making it attractive for people to come in on the back of this to actually invest, not just for carbon markets, but also for all the co-benefits.
That's fantastic. And certainly the MRV and being able to quantify the contributions that we know, especially empirically, that SRI is having, is going to go a long way in helping to increase the number of hectares, the number of farmers that adopt these practices. Very exciting. Adnan, would you be able to share an overview of your work with Links Nigeria?
Hi, good morning everyone, and thanks for having me here. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to talk about what the Links Project is doing in Northern Nigeria. So the Links Project started in 1920 with a model that we call paddy hog model. And the focus was in increasing farmer yields to kind of address the efficiency in the entire value chain. By 2020, already, we had a little bit of shift into more climate sensitive, more environment resilient approach when we had a separate funding from the UK PAP project, when we were mandated to develop projects that are sensitive to environment, and then there comes our SRI journey. We approached SRI similar to all the designs that Erica had over the years. But what we do is we do it in the form of a farm field school. So we train farmers, and the farmers themselves establish field plots, learning plots, demonstration plots we call them, and each farmer trains 50 more farmers. What is interesting in our approach is that each of the main SRI events, that is the early establishment, the increased density, reduced density, grape planting, the AWD, everything is done like a field event. So the farmer gathers farmers and they do it like a hymn. All the 50 farmers have to be there to see how it is done. So far, we are in our fourth season, so there are two production seasons in Nigeria, the rainy and the dry season. We're in our fourth season, and we've seen tremendous growth in how SRI is living, and we're expanding to more areas within the country. actually a very opportune time when we are talking about the system for ice intensification, because I think this is something, as Eric has said, like it's long gone. Finally got a berth in the COP discussions. So I'll step back and say that system for COP intensification is something which is gaining momentum because of the increasing dependence on natural resources and also an increasingly fluctuating natural resource base, which we are finding in many of our countries. So I would like to pose like five questions, because I think this is something which we have now, without any doubt, been proven as a successful model, where there is a, if not anything, 30% increase in yields, 30% less water use, and substantial reduction in fertilizer use. What else we can we should expect to counter the effects of climate change, at the same time to adapt more into the livelihood, what do you call, more economical agriculture from that point of view. So, in terms of my first question, is there, do we have enabling policies to upscale this particular model of financing? Because we have seen, as part of the Commonwealth Climate Finance Access Hub, where we place advisors in the member countries to support the countries in accessing finance and building policies around that. Still, the policies around water use, the policies around energy efficiency and agriculture, the policies around fertilizer use, seeds, so it's still having the kind of subsidy angle linked to it, which ideally keeps the farmers fixed to the traditional agriculture. So I think whether we as practitioners and implementers on the ground, can we bring in enough evidences to feed back to the policy makers to see if there could be a policy change when it comes to decisions around rice production. And for example, like a country like India, we have got our maximum rice production coming from zones which are highly impacted by groundwater depletion and rainfall erraticity. The second question is basically around financing mechanisms around this. So we have a traditional financing mechanism which are bank driven, which is basically based on the bankability of the models. So we need to, based on these successful experiences from countries, including what my co-panelists discussed from Nigeria in terms of how it basically became a successful model there, can we bring financing solutions or financing models there, or bankable models there, which can directly give confidence to the farmers to invest in SRI and not in the flood advice system? And the third question is like the human and institutional capacities, because I've been like working on agriculture systems in many countries, including the federated structures of farmers to the special purpose vehicles. But you know, the orientation is always towards the market when we grow in agriculture, and rather than towards farmers. So obviously when we orient towards farmers, whether your institutional architecture and the capacity of the farmers to play in that space is there or not is a big question. And so we are posed with this question time and again when we access finance. Because when you go to the banks or NDBs or the GCFs to get finance for this project, you know, all these questions start coming. Okay, we are ready to give finance, but will you be able to implement at scale? Because I saw the figure of 50 million hectares by 2030. 50 million hectares by 2030 for some countries is a big
problem.
So we need, but at the same time, the transmittive impact on the ground, if you grow at that scale, is also substantial. And the last question is about, are we replicating these models between? And I was very happy to hear the Farmers Field School replicating one farmer going to 50 farmers. I think the same thing can happen between countries, between the rice growing. So I've seen the great work that Cornell University has done basically to replicate these models from multiple regions with the CGIAR systems and with the UN systems. But I think the more, what do you call, capsule bankable models, if we can share with member countries, looking at their own socioeconomic situation, definitely will
Yes.
The big ask is like the high yielding varieties are replacing the traditional varieties, but can SRA be a vehicle to bring back the traditional varieties? So these are some of the questions that these are not my questions, these are the questions that the member countries ask us, actually. I just would like to host here for a discussion. Thank you very much.
Wow. You really raise a lot of issues. I think some of it goes back to what Jack said at the beginning, that agriculture is very much part of the solution. And sometimes the expectations of donors and financiers versus the reality of the pace of change in agriculture are somewhat conflicting. And this idea of a model that can be scaled, I mean, I think SRI is the perfect one because it's principle-based. It's not a cut and paste, which we all know doesn't work. So how can we answer the questions that you pose and make sure and adjust it for every context for greater success? I'd like to turn back to Erica and ask if you can share how SRI is an effective method for tackling both climate and food security together and its relevance for the Americas and for the global.
Well, thank you. Big question. Well, maybe I'll bring the topic back to the plant, you know, because SRI is an agronomic method. So basically what we try to do is put the plant in its best place so that in its best environment so it can really produce its full potential. And with that, you know, we want to like see that roots, the root growth is enhanced, which then by also enhances the shoot growth in the grain field. So we have a super productive plant that is well anchored in the soil. And it's a knowledge-based approach, as you mentioned. So farmers can adapt it to their own environment. Now we know also that 80% of rice is produced by smallholder farmers who have not many resources available to or access to resources. So food security is, of course, a huge challenge for smallholder farmers. And so I think SRI, because we can, through a knowledge-based approach, we can increase yields. So what it does, first of all, the households can become food secure, produce enough rice. I mean, that's already a big, then if there's enough rice, people can bring their rice to the market, so there's an income that can be created. So to insecure, become food secure. You can even get more funding. If that is now achieved, you can also like take rice out of production and grow something else. So we are in crop diversification, farming system diversification, nutritional food security diversification. Otherwise, SRI also allows to produce organic. You can move towards organic production. In many places in Southeast Asia, you have old systems where rice is associated with fish, with crab, with ducks. Now, if we have all the chemicals putting into the rice paddies, people losing all that have lost. In Vietnam, people have lost those systems. So with SRI, able to produce organically again and to create different types of food security systems, again, which were traditional, which we were talking. So huge implication of food security. Now, as the plants have strong roots, deep roots, and are strong plants, they adapt to climate change better. So drought or dry spells during the cropping seasons, which is something that will occur more and more often. Flood events, storm events, pests and diseases. So plants are stronger, deeper rooted, they can overcome those events much better. So farmers don't have to lose a crop, gain a crop, lose a crop, but you know, we can produce more consistently. And then the mitigation, which has been already alluded to in the video, up to 70% less methane emissions, which is a huge, which is a huge. So again, SRI can be applied to, we come to that again for the Americas. You know, Americas have extremely diverse cropping systems, from smallholder to medium scale to the very, very large scale modernized cropping systems. But we have seen that SRI can be adapted to all three systems. And I think it's a huge potential. we just have to kind of maybe be more rigorous in analyzing it and then creating those models and sharing those models more efficiently so that people can think about it.
Thank you, Erica. Yeah, for sure. There's so many entry points with SRI and in the Americas. You know, we have Chile interested because they've been suffering a mega drought for 20 years. Peru interested because the alternate wetting and drying helps reduce malaria. Ecuador interested because they're renewing their irrigation infrastructure. Panama, the Dominican Republic, because they're interested in a more competitive production system. So I think the multiple benefits you pointed out are certainly effective. And then can you please share some of the results from your LEAPS project that you found with implementing SRI and relate a little bit to food security at different levels in Nigeria?
Okay, thank you very much. So to date, in the LEAPS project, we've trained about 5,106 smallholder farmers in the farmer field schools directly. We're working also with large-scale producers and aggregators that have adopted SRI through their outgrower schemes and also some in-grower schemes where they are actually directly producing through SRI. The findings from our pilot for our plots have shown yield increases of between 50 to 100% in product fields. We've seen farmers that produce 7 to 10 to 50 kg bags in their fields having 31 to 32 bags in 0.25 of a hectare. It's unprecedented. So another thing we found was that the methodology reduces the use of inputs, especially fertilizer and seeds, by up to 40% in some places. So for us, the main thing is the increase in yield and the reduction in production costs. So this ensured that the farmers have more profit, and once they have more profit, like Erica said, they kind of start to intensify, to open up more land, because you know they because of the money with them, the amount of resources they have to just produce rice in smaller plots. But once they can be able to have much more money, they open up, and this definitely we have seen it increasing the output from farmer fields. Nigeria loves its rice. We are a very rice loving country. We have seen governments praised or criticized based on the amounts of rice that the country is able to produce. So what we are seeing is that increased output from farmer fields will make our many rice mills more efficient and more productive, and this will definitely, or has been definitely, leading to creation of new jobs, more revenues to states and local governments. And we feel the more we do with SRI, the more those benefits will skyrocket. If you estimate, I think from 2013-14, we've shown that by 2035, we need about 113 million tons of rice to feed the whole world. And the alarming thing is about 40% of that demand is from Africa. So Nigeria has been the largest producer and largest importer and largest eater of rice, for lack of a better word. I think pushing SRI will really help the country in achieving the rice independence that not just the current president, but everybody in the country really want to see happening. Because if Nigeria is rice secure, the whole Western and Central African region is actually rice secure. So we're hoping to get there with SRI.
Wish you a lot of luck with that. That's a huge challenge, but sounds like SRI is a key part of the solution. Sudhir, what role do you think SRI can play in the Commonwealth's agenda, not only for climate, but also for land restoration and biodiversity?
one of the things that downforce can do, of course, is to put that footprint, that hallmark on why SRI rise should literally be sitting with a price premium, because in the end, this is where it's all going to come down to it. If we can not only create more yield, but when that yield that does make it out of the farm and out of the house and onto the marketplace, you literally want to see that there's an encouraging signal in the marketplace. So whether it's through traceability, whether it's through being able to put numbers against it, I think these are all incredibly important elements. And genuinely speaking, it's not going to move, and policies will not move unless there's a consumer product. It has to be there. We hear again and again that it's not going to be done just for the sake of, you know, being good and getting the tip. So I think what role I see, for example, Downforce is playing is being able to give that confidence to the banks, to the markets, to the farmers, that if they make the switch, people are going to value that food, not just for the yield, but also because we can detect the changes in biodiversity, the changes on water that actually occur when you switch to that transformed way of growing rice. And I think that's really important, that SRI is not just about the crop, it's about the whole ecosystem in which the crop is growing that could potentially benefit significantly. And that's a whole other corpus, just as the crop worker said, there's three big conventions that come in, all to use the biodiversity and so on. So in Kenya, where SRI exists, has for many, many years, when you go there, you see on the ground, I live in Kenya, you see on the ground the difference between farmers who grow SRI as opposed to the large rice growing. And we grow a lot of rice in Kenya as well, I tell you. So I have one question really, which is, can you taste the difference? Or is it down to the traditional seeds that will give that palatability? And if there was a way we could also, a bit like Peshwari rice or, you know, whichever different kinds of rice we have, whether there's something very distinctive that we could also bring to people. You know, the deliciousness of rice grown in this way, I mean, that would be the ultimate branding, as well as all the good things it does to the world.
Very interesting question, and maybe I can divert very quickly if Erica wants to just speak very quickly about it. Okay. So first, Anand, do you want to mention a little bit why SRI is effective compared to conventional rice when tackling greenhouse gas emissions? Results
of the energy. Okay, yeah, I think Professor Erica actually said a lot about that. It all comes down to the plant, right? Like, okay, rice is very, very adaptable. I think we all know that. Right? When you give it plenty of space and you give it plenty of resources, it gives you back very plenty of output. And all that matters for rice is the tiller. Tillers is the rice able to produce. So in our conventional fields, what actually happens is that rice is packed densely, so it doesn't get to really grow into its conventional tiller. And another thing is what the transplanted late in Nigeria, they transplant sometimes 24 days. They allow it to go 24 days in the field. And at that point, you don't know what you're planting. Is it a mother plant or a primary tiller or even a secondary tiller, so you don't get that robustness in growth. But with SRI, you plant early, 9 to 12 days, that ensures that you have definitely planted a mother plant that is not a tiller. So all the potential tillering will be from that single plant. And then for us, we increase the spacing of the plants. We plant in 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter grids, as opposed to the 15, 20 centimeter that the farmers plant. So this also ensures that there is very good rooting, there is very good space for the tillers to be produced. And then when you have a better rooting system and overall better PCM, the fact is that you get a lot of sink for the products that are coming after photosynthesis. So it's not just the, you know, the plant there, it's the fact that you have an aerobic soil. And if the soil is aerobic, then you know that less methane is emitted during respiration. So it's really, I think, for lack of a better word, a lot of farmers call it an unusual methodology. And we like it that SRI is unusual, but it's been proven So one of the things that really pushed us was that we had very little information on actual measurements, especially of methane emissions from this high space. Most of the studies we encountered are about water yields. So we really made it a duty that we have to measure emissions. We really have to in our pilots. And it was really interesting for us because we saw about 18 to 41% reduction in emissions from SRI kits. Although in very small plots, but we are really refining our methodologies. We are working with a very good center in the Economic Center for Center for Dryland Agriculture. They developed a kind of static closed chamber technique, and we collect gases at different stages and we measure them. So we've really seen this through data, although we are trying to expand additional studies, and also we've done studies to see soil carbon changes and carbon sequestration potentials. And for us, the best output we've seen is from the really carbon sequestration potentials of the SRI fields. This, we believe, is due to the organic amendments that we see. So it's really out there, and there's a lot of evidence as well to show that it works.
There's so many interconnected positive impacts. It's really fascinating. Erica, would you like to maybe perhaps comment a little bit, maybe not on the quality, but on how we're looking to add value for rice production with SRI and Suriname? And also speak a little bit about the importance and role of marginalized groups and how SRI can impact it.
Yeah, thank you for the socioeconomic aspects. I think there's many different socioeconomic outcomes and benefits. Especially, as SRI is knowledge-based, we have benefit to women farmers, for instance, is huge because very often it's the women who are growing the food crops for a family, and rice in some places is a food crop. So women usually don't get the inputs. They go first to the cash crops, the tractors, whatever, things are dedicated to the cash crop, and the woman has to deal with trying to grow whatever she can for her family. So with SRI now, I've seen in countries where women suddenly see that actually just with my own resources, I can improve yields. So I can feed my family, not by having to go outside to get more inputs, but by mobilizing my own resources. So I think that makes a huge difference. Also, we have seen health benefits for women, very important ones, when women have to weed in flooded fields during irrigated paddies. Very often get sick and have a lot of pain. So with SRI, as we don't flood, and we have upright leaders, it takes a lot of away from the labor toll. Youth, I think youth is another important aspect because youth is many. I've seen young farmers in Africa want to go into rice production. They're trying to, but they can't never produce enough not to get in debt, or they have to migrate seasonally. So they go into real capital to get some money to come back. So you can never become a good farmer, as you've always been taught. Where's the money? Where's the money? Where's the money? So I met this farmer in Gambia who said, finally, I can be home and be a good farmer. I can grow my rice and make some money, and I do not have to run to the capital. And I mean, if we're thinking about this, the larger social and social movements, migration, etc., if you can be grounded within your community, growing the food you like to grow, and be independent, I mean, that's another added benefit. And then maybe with the traditional seeds, we talked about traditional communities. If you think about rice, has been around for thousands of years. People have domesticated their varieties. They have developed varieties that are adapted to soil, to salt water, to weed pressure, to various different soils for hundreds and thousands of years. So you have these varieties that are there, and now to bring to the farmers, where the farmers already have. So like have a lot of resources, you know. And I think sometimes I think like 80% of the solutions are already with the farmers. We just have to kind of like understand it, connect to it, and bring it up. And the same with the varieties. With SRI also, you have better grain filling. The rice grains are bigger, so there's quality. It doesn't break as quickly, you know. The quality of the grain becomes better, so for the consumer, it's a better rice. And the other part is, and that's something that, and now I'm getting excited, you know, I work with Jubilee Justice in the south of the USA, and we grow organic regenerative rice with specialty varieties. In the US, you don't have any specialty varieties. Everybody plants commodity rice. So with SRI, we can do that now. We bring in new rice, black rice, red rice, risotto rice, jasmine rice, all these different types that are, through SRI, you have really fully developed kernels, high quality, and so we can basically develop that value chain, you know, that we were saying, and educate people with it. And the other benefit, yeah, so that's, you know, it goes around in so many ways.
So here the hub and spokes model, the hub is located in the government of Mauritius. So the government of Mauritius houses the hub, and then the spokes, as we call, are all in multiple countries where these natural resource challenges are currently outside. So definitely there's a great opportunity for cross-learning, cross-replication of ideas, and we come up time to time with speakers. So far we have accessed around 56 million worth of projects for the member countries, around 17 countries, different projects of different categories, from agriculture to readiness to adaptation planning, etc. But what we also do is to capture those successful models and share it with the other member countries for quicker replication. So potentially if there is one project on agriculture fisheries that is successfully done in one country, there's always a possibility that in a lesser time we can replicate it in another country of similar geographical and socioeconomic condition. So that's potentially one platform, which is a very multilateral platform that we have to support countries in taking this initiative. We'll be happy to work with you and take your SRI and the knowledge to the other parts, because we are currently in Caribbean, Pacific, Asia, and the African region. 17 countries we are present, so definitely those countries where we have our advisors on the ground, definitely we can do in the short term potential, we can take the knowledge to those countries and see how we can develop them into business models.
Thanks so much for that. In a similar vein, Jackie, how do you think interregional collaboration and coordination can help accelerate these efforts?
I think where we need connection at every level. This really is a sort of multi-level actor process. And so networks of farmers are absolutely essential. I love the idea, you know, that the peer-to-peer learning, that will always work to at least mobilize the local appetite for change. But you need to underpin that with networks of, and then this is the question, investors who will come together. So people like groups like True Footprint and others who are really committed to SRI, connecting them up as almost pre-financing, so we're not necessarily having to go to the SACOs, to the local cooperatives, but creating an ability for maybe 30,000 one-hectare smallholders to come together at scale. So in a way, we need our new kinds of networks
innovation ecosystem around that has many multiple components. Speaking of that, Adnan, on the ground, what have been the main obstacles or challenges implementing and promoting SRI's expansion? What solutions have you come across?
That is a difficult place to discuss a lot of time. For us, the first main issue was reception. So farmers, for a very long time, we used to grow some rice in ponds and puddles of water. Like almost everybody believes that rice can never grow without water. But at a point, it was easy for us to talk to them. So our farmers plant in not as big ponds as you see in Asia and other parts. So on the edges of the ponds, there's a number of rice that is not completely covered, and these are the ones that grow best. So farmers know that, and we tell them, well, imagine if the entire pond is like that. And that was a major entry point for us. So it was a huge issue, you know, this perception of water. And the second big one was the age of the crop, like 2 6 days, 2 leaf days, 9 days. It was difficult to remove from the measurement, it was difficult to transplant. It was a lot of work. People just didn't believe it could work. Like 2 3 days after transplanting, farmers go and looking for what they transplant. And it was scary for many, like, but the good thing is you start seeing a change a week, 1 week after that. Another issue we had was with the spacing. So usually what our farmers do is they just take the rice and just transplant anywhere. No breeding, no. So we had to bring a kind of a breeding system. We had to create like a big fork-like structure, like 4 hands and 30 centimeters apart. So after land preparation, they go and draw lines in the farm and they cross them. So the intersections of the lines is where we ask them to transplant. And it was good work. So some of our lead farmers, you know, they have the villagers coming to really laugh at them. Like, this is kindergarten stuff. But you know, after 2 weeks, everybody was just amazed as how, you know, uniform the distribution was. So majorly it was actually perception and the drudgery that comes with the initial practices. But what we did was that, apart from our field schools, we did a lot of media campaigns, especially on the radio. Northern Nigeria, I think, is the capital of radio listeners in the world. Our people listen to radio. Like, you go to the remotest of villages, you see the herdsmen with their radio, the farmers with their radios. So we targeted that. We do weekly SRI programs in the local language, and it was hugely popular. We reached millions of people through that, and we're getting people calling us to train them on SRI. Like, cluster of farmers, come and show us. We had people going long distances to visit our demo fields. And when we really grew, we started taking the actual farmers to the radio stations to talk about their farms, their successes. And that really, really got us so far. And it really got us to get to more people, to more, not just smallholder farmers, but large-scale producers, rice mills that own large number of farms. They wanted us to train their direct producers on SRI. So the thing for us that was really interesting is our whole team was on the ground through the initial skepticism, you know, the early hopes. They saw the plants growing, and we were all there to celebrate the early successes, and it was really, really, really nice for us. Most of these problems that were, you know, there early, the late success, you know, the sheer number of bags that they got from those farms. And those farmers were tricky, you know. When we worked with them initially, they refused to give us their best fields. You want to try something? Well, take these fields that. Even if it doesn't produce well. Yeah, but then they got the best yields from their worst fields. So they now started moving to the very best fields. So overall, that was really, really a very great experience, and we're still loving where it's going.
Thank you. So we're running
testing mechanisms we work with in development and research is 3 to 4 years, if you want. It's 2 years. Give a little seed fund, do a little this, a little that. We go stop. And sometimes we can't even, you know, get to actually the points where we should be making an impact or where we could address the issues that farmers have. So yes, we need, we need at least 10-year horizons. I mean, funding mechanisms need to change. The decision makers need to change that approach to if we want to change agriculture. That's really, really, really important. So if that can change, then we can get to work and we can change agriculture.
Okay, yes, so for me first, it's governments, local, regional, promote and support SRI. Second is research development in the private sector. In Africa, it's crazy difficult. We almost have no, you know, smallholder farmer-centric equipment for transplanting, for harvesting. So we need a lot of research on that. And third is the access to finance bit that I can talk about. SRI farmers need to be funded. Like our project, we're right now testing a special kind of model, financing model that we develop. Because the farmers wouldn't fund the farmers. Our banks couldn't fund the farmers directly. So we brought them together, we designed through our access to finance team a model that could be replicated. So these two things, support from government, private sector, and of course access to finance.
Yeah, I think I'll reiterate the points that I mentioned in the beginning. Enabling policies and fit for purpose financing, which includes both financial instruments and financing approaches, and then of course institutional capacities and human capacities. And that's where the behavioral change comes. So basically,
very quickly, I think that we know it works. We know it can work at scale. So the piece that misses for me is actually joining those two together. We need a proper conversation with the financial side, with the data, and actually with farm groups. And if we can get that, maybe the FAO or others institutionally, we need to have that conversation.